Well, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jack Segal. Welcome back to Beyond the Headlines. Today we're returning to our series about Germany in the 20th century, and we have the good fortune once again of welcoming back a real expert on that topic, among many others, I would add. It's a great pleasure to welcome back Brian McCall. Brian McCall is Instructor of History and Political Science at the Interlochen Arts Academy. He's been a member of the faculty there since 1998. He also serves as an adjunct American History Instructor at Northwestern Michigan College and other universities and colleges in this area. He did his postgraduate study in history at Central Michigan University and has a Master of Arts in British History from the University of Strathclyde in Scotland. He also has an MA in American History and a BS in Secondary Education from Central Michigan University. Now let's get started by welcoming back Brian McCall to Beyond the Headlines.
Thank you, Jack, for having me. It's great fantastic to be here.
Thank you for being here. We have been moving along in a very complex and fascinating history of 20th century Germany, and maybe be good for the viewers who haven't seen the series for a little while to go back to the Weimar Republic and talk a bit about what went on during that period, what those years were, and what they were like for the Germans.
Well, in the aftermath of the defeat, and it was a defeat, of the Imperial German Army in 1918, in November, in the armistice, the German state fell apart in the days before the armistice took place. And the there was a revolution in Berlin. There were many different competing groups for power inside Berlin who wanted, most of all, the war to end and peace to be break out. In the end, the socialists were the ones who were able to take control of the government, and they were the ones who were then forced by the army to make the armistice deal that ended up setting up the end of the war of World War I, and then getting Germany into a post-war period. In the aftermath of the Treaty of Versailles, which goes into effect in 1919, Weimar Germany, which is a Weimar is a little town in eastern Germany that if you go there today, this is its one claim to fame, is that it was the capital of the German state in the aftermath of World War I until 1933. And the government that gets established there is a republic with a elected parliament and a prime minister, which in the German term would be called a chancellor. There were some other government agencies too, and the Weimar system was very, very weak compared to the imperial system that had preceded it in World War I. So given the structure was weak, add on all of the disastrous results of the World War I conflict in Germany. 2.5 million battlefield deaths, tens of thousands of wounded soldiers returning back home with missing legs and arms, and now we know to call it PTSD, but that back then, you know, incredible numbers of people in shell shock, widows and orphans. Germany itself physically had not been destroyed in World War I. The Allies did not have the ability to do strategic bombing in 1917 and 1918. They flew some missions over Germany, but the planes back then weren't able to really do a lot of damage. And when the armistice was signed, there were no British, American, or French soldiers inside Germany proper. They were all still in France or in Belgium. So Germany's physical plant was still intact, but its treasuries were absolutely depleted. The reparations that the Treaty of Versailles put in place were enormous and incredibly, you know, when you think about the we've talked about this on one of the earlier shows of the motivation behind the people who won the war, and the Allies did win. There's no question the German army was broken. Hitler and the Nazis will come to power using the idea that the army had been stabbed in the back, is what they said, by the socialists when they made the peace deal for the armistice, but that's absolutely completely false. Germany had no ability to defend itself. That said, no Allied soldier had walked into Germany while the war was still going on. So you had these huge reparations.
So the reparations are payments back,
to the Allies to repair all the war damage, and it was an enormous amount of war damage. And then the Germans, as part of the Treaty of Versailles, signed part of the document that said we were at fault for the war. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't have to review the shows we did earlier, although you can watch them all on YouTube, which is fantastic. But that's a gross simplification of what really had happened before 1914. Germany was instrumental in the outbreak of World War I, but they were certainly not alone. And they didn't act as a completely, you know, detached aggressor who just blew the whole world system apart on their own. That's not what happened. But that's what they were told had happened, and they had to sign that paper to say it happened. All of this meant Weimar Germany came into being with so many disadvantages. When you think about what the 20th century could have looked like, it's a great, again, we on earlier shows, we talk about counterfactuals. The counterfactual of a Germany that had a stronger central government based in democratic norms without this reparation payment and some understanding on the part of everybody involved in World War I that they were, if not equally responsible for the outbreak of war, everyone had a part in making that happen. But that's not what happened. And so the resentments and tensions and weaknesses that are going to bring the Nazis to power eventually are laid early on in the history of post-war Germany. And Weimar is now kind of a code for a weak government that can't do what people expect it to do and therefore is blamed for everything that goes wrong in the country. And that's kind of where they were right up until about 1924. And then something very interesting happens. The hyperinflation that we talked about earlier, the Germans state to pay their war debt decide to push the button on the printing press and tape it down. And they begin printing money in enormous amounts. This in turn caused this destabilizing of the economy. Germany's money becomes worthless.
Wipes out people's savings.
Yeah. Middle class people, people who are really hardworking, respectable people, lost everything. Again, setting the stage for early supporters of the Nazi Party. The world economy in 1923 began to have big shocks applied to it because of the collapse of the German Reichmark. And the United States government, the Treasury Department, went to several American bankers in New York and other places around the Western world and said, we need to do something to stop this spinning out of control of Germany's economy. And they came up with what was called the Dawes Plan. And it's a pretty interesting and ingenious idea. Money was loaned to the German banks, financial institutions, and the state. They, in turn, could pay their war reparations with these American guaranteed loans. They paid them to the British and the French who were holding these reparations contracts. The British and French in turn could then finance and pay back some of the money that they had borrowed from the American banks to win World War I, and the pump got primed and the American and the world economy started to sync up together. By 1926-27, 2 years after the Dawes Plan goes into effect, Weimar Germany and Germany itself they haven't completely recovered economically, but they had a version of the Roaring Twenties that began in the middle part of the decade of the '20s, and picked up steam through 1928 all the way to October 1929.
So U.S. money goes to German states who paid French and British banks who repay their debts to American banks. That sounds like a self-licking ice cream cone.
That's exactly what it was, but that's trade.
Yeah, so that gets you to the stock market crash of October 1929.
Yeah. The Germans at that time, remember, they had an incredibly well-developed internal economy that they had built during the unification process that Bismarck instituted, who we talked about in our very first show.
Since the 1850s on.
That's right. Yeah. But what happens in the 1920s is the Germans develop, they need money, they need cash, they start developing export products. And they start exporting things like pens, optics,
I think we're still buying them from the same companies.
We are. highly specialized machine tools. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a very advanced mm-hmm. industrial base. Mm-hmm. And their export economy, and plus they did some other things, toys. If you remember growing up like I do, I grew up in the 60s and 70s, I remember when you could buy toys from Japan that still had this mark on them of really being tin, cheap.
Yeah, yeah.
You bought them
yeah.
at the Five and Dime store, yeah. junky toy. Mm-hmm. But that was one of the ways that the Japanese rebuilt their economy after mm-hmm. World War II. The Germans do the same thing. Mm-hmm. They used exported consumer goods and industrial products to start building back up. Mm-hmm. And by 27, 28, they're well on their way to recovery. In fact, so much so that the French and the British were wondering what was going to happen when the reparation payments would be paid off, and they would no longer have this extra money coming in from France, from Germany to help finance their mm-hmm. post-war economies. Mm-hmm. That's how well Germany had done. But when 1929 happens, again, world economic events have huge implications to world politics,
Now, how did the German people feel about they had lost territory as a result of World War I as well? How sensitive were they to that issue?
Very. And sections of the Versailles Treaty took away the Saar area of Germany, which is where a lot of their coal came from. Small, mm-hmm. but very productive. The French and British armies, and then later just the French, occupy the Rhineland. Mm-hmm. And the Germans cannot put military forces anywhere near the Rhine River. It's a demilitarized zone for them and a French-occupied zone for at least through half the 20s before the French finally pulled out. But the big losses were in the east. They lost what was most of East Prussia, mm-hmm. became part of Poland. They had lost the city of Danzig as a German city, and it became a split free state city, if you want to call it that. The Polish name for today is Gdansk, but mm-hmm. Danzig for many Germans was as German a city as Berlin or Dusseldorf. Mm-hmm. Now it's under Polish control in effect, or international control. The Polish corridor, which had been put up into the Baltic Sea, so Poland would have access to the Baltic, that took land right away from the Germans. Mm-hmm. They lost part of Silesia. They'd lost a huge chunk of the imperial system that Bismarck had built in 1871. A lot of that was gone now. If you superimpose the two maps, you can see how much territory they lost.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing they lost, probably more than territory, was self-respect and a feeling of there were very few people in Germany, I would say maybe with the exception of the veterans, the thoughtful veterans, like those that saw the war as a disaster, who believed that they had been treated fairly by the world in the aftermath of World War I. All Germans seemed to be tarred with this militarism and need for authoritarianism, and the resentment built up pretty heavily, especially again who we talked about, the middle class people, mm-hmm. who saw themselves as Germans first. And the nationalism that Hitler is going to use to his advantage got its stoked power and fire in these years of the 20s, the early 20s in particular.
So this identification, let's say, with Bavaria, maybe that was one mm-hmm. more somewhat exceptional. Still people felt ties to Bavaria because it was Catholic and so on. But for the rest of the lands, the lender, the states of the German Reich, it's still mm-hmm. the Reich at this point.
Yeah, it is still called the Reich.
They were loosening the hold on the people were starting to think of themselves as Germans.
The Treaty of Versailles did not apply to the German states. It applied to what was Imperial Germany. Uh-huh. And the concept of a united national Germany as something that's dangerous, as something that the world has to fear, many Germans resented that. Mm-hmm. They felt that was mm-hmm. an unfair characterization. And some of them felt like we deserve to be. The French have a nationalized strong central government. Mm-hmm. Germany deserves to have this too. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And again, you know, you can't go back and do too much with counterfactuals, but the idea that the Great Depression, if there'd have been a way to make the Great Depression less of a shock to the world economy, perhaps some of these feelings would have been mitigated by the fact that the economy would eventually come back, and when people have money in their pocket, these ideas about lost lands and lost pride maybe will be less important. Mm-hmm. But of course, that's not what happened. Mm-hmm.
So there are people, you seem to be describing a thirst for a new Germany, a new image of Germany, and there's something coming down the pike to deliver that.
Yeah. Again, imagine that the Allied armies of 1918, instead of stopping the war on November 11th, had rejected the armistice terms, and in effect said, nope, we're going to do what Abraham Lincoln did to the American South in the American Civil War. We're going to fight for unconditional surrender. Mm-hmm. The armistice was based on the proposition that Germany, in some form or another, would remain intact. But imagine that the United States military, which was amped up to do most of the fighting in 1919, they were ready to go. Our war effort really started to pour the soldiers in. Our own equipment started to be used and more. We had kind of transitioned in many of our units away from using French guns to American guns. Mm-hmm. Our production of shells, rifles, helmets, everything, and most importantly, our men, because the British and the French were done. This would have been an American show, the spring and summer offensives of 1919, deep into Germany.
Which never happened.
And never happened. Had it happened, would we be having this discussion today about the rise of Hitler? Yeah. The second one is, what's the effect of the Great Depression? Mm-hmm. So, and that's kind of where we probably need to go here. When the Wall Street crash happens of October 1929, it doesn't take very long in Germany for the effects of having their markets cut off, because we know the reaction of most national governments to the initial crash in 1929 was what? Tariffs? Breaking off trade, making imported goods more expensive. This is what Germany had been living on. Yeah. And the credit dried up. The Dawes plan, in effect, ceased to run.
The U.S. banks were not lending.
U.S. banks stopped lending.
Yeah.
The unemployment that people had very fresh memories of from 1919, 1920, 1921 comes back with a vengeance by 1930. Mm-hmm. And as we know in our own history of the Depression here in the United States, it felt like there was no end. Every month, things got worse. Mm-hmm. The weakness of the Weimar government comes out in full view of everyone.
Of course, every government was struggling to respond.
French,
to that.
British, yeah. Everyone US, was. Yeah. United States, no one had an answer for the Great Depression, but nobody in those other countries had Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. And the Nazi Party ready to step in.
So who were the parties that might have played a role at that stage? You had the Nazis.
You have the Nazis, and they're small through the 20s. They built a core, and in national elections through the 20s, they really never get much more than 10 to 15% of the vote. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people didn't take them very seriously because, you know, there's a lot of flags and uniforms and the rhetoric was just crazy over the top. And depending on where you were and who you listened to, there was so much anti-Semitism, which most Germans were mildly
if not
solidly anti-Semitic.
They were tolerant.
Yeah, they were tolerant of anti-Semitism. Yeah. They would listen to it. Mm-hmm. But the Nazis seemed obsessed with it. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, it seemed a little odd. You know, it's kind of a weird thing to be worried about, especially the Jews were, 3% of Germany's population, small? And
in
Hitler,
the big cities, it was closer to 10% in Frankfurt, I remember.
That's
that,
right. Yeah. Hitler seemed clownish. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, it seems to be a very serious person. The whole story of him trying to, as we talked about in the last show, trying to force a revolution in Bavaria, the putsch that failed, his newspaper reports of the court case. By 1924-25, Hitler is a known figure in Germany, but not necessarily a respected one or feared one by many of the people who would have considered themselves keeping track of normalized politics. He was, you know, he was Hitler. And they didn't take him seriously. The Germans had, or the Nazis had organized a party mechanism in just about every state in Germany. It wasn't big, but it was present. They knew who their people were and how to reach them. And of all of the political parties, they cultivated their membership the most aggressively. Once you joined the Nazi Party or became interested in them, you wouldn't get rid of them. They would be on you all the time mm-hmm. to go to meetings, to participate. You get mailings. You were never forgotten. Mm-hmm. And they never neglected their voters or mm-hmm. their supporters. Their competitors, that's not the case. The socialists, probably the biggest potential block to the Nazis, had a compromised position vis-a-vis the communists. There was too much crossover between the Communist Party of Germany and people who were a member of the Socialist Party of Germany. The socialists had also been tarred with this Treaty of Versailles. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that stuck their names on the bottom of the page. The Catholic Center parties, kind of like conservative landowning parties. At one point there was 35, 36 different political parties in Germany too. Mm-hmm. Lots of competition between different groups. Almost every interest group had a political party. In American politics today, we basically have two, and if you have an interest in guns, you go to the NRA. If you're interested in choice, you join Planned Parenthood. Those things didn't exist in Germany. They formed political parties instead.
Separate little political parties. So 13 or 12 or 15% is not so small
no.
in a bifurcated system like that. And were the Nazis at that point still legally, they were working within a legal structure and they wanted to be within the law?
Well,
sort of.
That's a good point. The Nazis through this period murdered, and I mean murdered, dozens if not hundreds of their political opponents. Uh-huh. Almost every one of these murders is either unsolved or not investigated mm-hmm. or left open. And they murdered people mostly outside of their own organization. Primary targets would have been socialists and communists. They rarely murdered or targeted respectable conservative politicians who weren't Nazis. Mm-hmm. They would sometimes threaten these people, but they rarely pulled a trigger and shot them or kidnapped them or butchered them. But they had no trouble doing this with the socialists. Now, the part about the story in the 1920s is, you remember in the American experience at this point, we have an enormous amount of uptick in violence in the 1920s mm. related to prohibition. Mm. Mm-hmm. If you are in Great Britain or France, there's more violence related to labor strife mm-hmm. and some other, usually other political things. People getting out guns and shooting each other over strikes or politics was happening internationally, but it was happening in happened in Japan as well, but it's happening in Germany with a vengeance. Mm. The conservative politicians who lead the police forces of Germany make a concerted effort to ignore the Nazis. No one from official German government agencies go after the Nazis as criminals. They seem to take a hands-off approach to these murders because most of their victims were communists or socialists. And that's one of the things you can also go back and go, what if they had been treated as a crime organization as opposed to a political party? Mm-hmm. How long would the Nazis have been able to function if their leaders are being arrested and convicted of murder? That never happened, though. Even though they clearly committed dozens, if not hundreds, of these murders during this time.
So they are establishing themselves in the environment of a political system. Their activities are not completely out of the ordinary with what's going on around the world.
That's right.
So they're not exceptional that way. They seem a little bit weird to the people.
Well, my comparison would be. Think of the way that Chicago was operating in the 1920s as the Capone organization fought it out with the other mm-hmm. bootleggers in the Chicago area, and they had politicians and judges and mm-hmm. prosecutors completely either on the take or terrified to do anything about them. That's mm-hmm. if you look at Hitler as a gangster during this period, put him in a fedora as opposed to a uniform, and stand him on a street corner with you know, with white spats on and make him like Al Capone. It's a different way of approaching him, isn't it? I mean, most people, when they think about his rise to power, they don't think about the violence that his organizing, whether or not Hitler ever killed anybody personally during this period, probably not, but certainly he had no trouble with his thugs going out and killing and terrorizing people that he disagreed with.
And when does he start talking about the making Germany great again? What is that in this?
Right from the beginning.
Right from the beginning, okay.
Yes.
Mein Kampf and on.
Yeah, and when he, you know, before the putsch in 1923, he had been pretty well known in Bavaria and Munich as a speaker at beer, you know, at beer halls and different public gatherings. The circus in Berlin, or in, in Munich was where his, a lot of his speeches took place, where he would go in there and rail about how only he could save Germany, and he was the only one who could use the Nazi Party effectively to transform it and end all of the things that had happened, all because of the Jews and different other people. So this had, this went back a long way. His message didn't change very much from his rise as a politician in 1919-1920. Really, you could say, until his death in the bunker, but.
So how do we get, from the, we've got the great crash of 29 and the subsequent couple of years of economic dislocation all over the world.
Right.
And Germany is not exempt, so they're under tremendous strain. How, who is it that gets, begins to get Germany's economy back on its feet? Is that, is Hitler in a position to do anything about that?
Not until he's appointed in 1933. And let's go back to the Weimar government, too, a little bit about this. There's a president of Germany, and his name is Paul von Hindenburg. We mentioned him before in the earlier shows, one of the most successful generals of the German general staff. He becomes the president as a representative of kind of a conservative, landowning, traditional Germany that would kind of bridge the gap between this industrial powerhouse that it had become and its older traditions of, you know, landowners and Länder and that kind of thing.
The big elite, they run the country.
Very much a, like a grandfather figure. And he is a politician only in the sense that he took this position not because he probably wanted power over Germany, but he, because he felt that nobody else could do it. At heart, he was much more of a general. And if you know anything about Hindenburg, he wasn't the most motivated or active person even while he was a general. Most of his military decisions were made for him by Ludendorff, his lieutenant, and he agreed to them. So that kind of passive behavior as the president of Germany continues. But, you know, I would say that, you know, Herbert Hoover in 1930, 1931, 32. Totally, completely, just absolutely flattened by the Depression. Did not know. Here's a Stanford graduate, a fantastic civil engineer, the best of the brightest. Herbert Hoover, you could have probably have never picked a better person to be president, and they couldn't he couldn't figure out how to deal with the Great Depression. So Hindenburg and the Depression, there's no chance for him to really change Germany's economic direction. That's not him. Enter the Nazis. And in 1932, the Germans have a series of elections. I believe they had four that year, four parliament seats, plus other elections in the states. And in every election until the last one, the Nazis got a bigger and bigger and bigger share. But they never got 51%. They topped out in the second-to-last election, I believe, at 37. And that's still not enough. No one would join the Nazis to form a coalition government. And the Nazis didn't want to join. They wanted a majority. You know, they were like, who would join us? The conservative Catholics? Or certainly not going to join with the socialists, even though they are called the National Socialist Party. This last election, in November of 32, the Nazis take a huge hit. They had overplayed their violent hand. And remember we said that up to this point, they generally didn't go after conservative politicians and respectable people. In the aftermath of their last election triumph, that's exactly what they did. They went after mayors, doctors, lawyers, judges, prosecutors. They never killed too many. They didn't kill too many of these people, but they threatened them. They beat them up. They threw bricks through their houses. They went on a rampage across Germany. German voters given a chance to vote against Hitler after that, they did. And so I think in the last show we said one of the greatest ironies and tragedies of human history, not just European and not just German, is that the politicians around Hindenburg in the aftermath of this last election make the case that the Nazis aren't really going away, that Hitler could be a help as opposed to an agent of disaster if he was brought into the government. And they make the offer to him to become the chancellor and convince Franz von Papen, who is the one who cooked up this idea, to make Hitler the chancellor of Germany with the understanding that he would work hand in glove with the president, Hindenburg, and von Papen as vice chancellor would keep an eye on him.
So who does what in that structure? The president, the chancellor, and the vice chancellor? Yeah.
It's complicated, and if you're American, it sounds a little odd. I mean, we have a president with, the president has enormous executive power. Yeah. The president of Germany had probably about half the executive power that an American president would have. He's got, the president of Germany, the office has the power to appoint. In a current German constitution, the president is much more of a head of state for ceremonial duties.
Figure
they have
head,
very
type,
little
yeah.
political influence.
Yeah.
They're sort of the conscience of Germany.
And the chancellor or prime minister.
Chancellor, prime minister, they make policy, and they also operate most of the executive branch. This was a little more split power between these three, and this vice chancellor position was very close to Hindenburg. The theory was that von Papen or anybody else who was in that would be a check on the Nazi, on Hitler as chancellor. So he became the head of state to the point that the Weimar Republic Constitution allowed him to. But remember, this is someone whose people had murdered dozens, hundreds. We don't know the total number of pre-rise to power victims of the Nazis, but it's an enormous number of people. He's a gangster. And now he's the chancellor. And because he's a gangster, he didn't play by Weimar constitutional Republican rules. And one of the first things that happen after he becomes chancellor is the fire in the Reichstag.
And the fire, this is the building that
it's the Capitol building.
Yeah.
It's approximately the same size as the U.S. Capitol. Uh-huh. You go to Berlin today.
Yeah.
It's gutted from the inside out. Who set that fire?
Still being debated.
Yes. They find a Dutch communist who's mentally disabled. He's executed for it later. But the fact that he could be portrayed as the protagonist, the terrorist who did this, gave Hitler the ability to, in effect, tell Hindenburg that he was going to put the state of Germany at his own disposal to protect it from further terrorist outrages. And they went on. Now he can have his stormtroopers go on a rampage. They're deputized as members of the state police now. That was not the case.
So it's kind of his own personal militia.
His personal militia that he had built. No other party had an army, literally, that's what they were, as part of their part of the political machinery, but the Nazis do.
Mm-hmm.
Those uniforms weren't just for show.
Mm-hmm.
Almost all Nazi party members who were in the SA had access to guns.
Mm-hmm.
And they have guns, they've got, remember Germany is a pretty organized place, and when you move house in Germany, even today, one of the things you need to do is you need to register with the police. So once the Nazis get access to the police stations, they've got access to everybody's address.
Mm-hmm.
On their address forms back then, they often asked for and received what political party are you members of? They knew who these socialists were. They knew who the labor organizers were. They go after these people. I mean, literally go after them. They arrest them. They can't find them. They arrest the families. They arrested so many people, they ran out of space for them. They put them in concentration camps, which had been around before in different countries. I think you can actually maybe say the United States is an early adapter of what we would call the concentration camp. They used them in the Philippines
during the Boer War.
The Boer War by the British. South Africa, yeah. It's not a new device, but it had never been used inside of one country to handle political opponents and people who had been arrested by the state. The prisons and the jails were full. So that's the beginning of the, here's the true face of who the Germans have gotten for their chancellor. And you can say, they never picked him. He was chosen. He was appointed. He wasn't voted on. Mm-hmm. One of the great myths about Hitler is the German people voted him into power. That's not what happened.
But he's still sharing with Hindenburg, but Hindenburg is now suddenly going to...
Well, Hindenburg's dying of cancer.
Yeah.
They didn't know that at the time, but he's clearly ill. And the other people around Hitler in the German state, particularly the army, which had been really severely limited in numbers, only had a 100,000-man army at this point. Germany's peacetime army of 1914 was 2.5 million. I mean, some crazy... huge number. Those army officers are the one group of people that Hitler doesn't have direct control over, even as chancellor. The army reports to Hindenburg, the president. And the army leaders, as Hindenburg began to show signs of dying, start to talk to Hitler. And they say that you have to take this militia, the SA, which is now over a million, maybe 2 million members, and you have to control them and dismantle them and put them away. You're now the chancellor. You don't need a private militia anymore to protect yourself from communists. You have the German army. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to have two armies in Germany. We're not going to have your private Nazi army and then the German army. They also make it clear that if he doesn't do this, that they're going to... They will not be responsible for what happens next to Hitler.
Threatening a coup, okay.
You got it. Mm-hmm. And this is not an idle threat. As a former member of the army, Hitler knew what they were probably capable of, if they felt that they were threatened as an institution by him or his people. And at the same time, this is happening inside. Can you imagine the people who now, the Nazis in 1928, the last thing they ever would imagine is they're now in power. I wouldn't say it was a game to them, but the idea that they would be, you know, now running Germany, and yet here they are, 5 years later in charge. Those people now, they want to have their vision of, they want the socialism part of the National Socialism agenda put in place. They want control over the national economy. They want to take money from rich people who they equate not just with Germans and Jews, but the rich as a corrosive part. There's a lot of anti-capitalist propaganda that the SA puts out. And, you know, you could say, well, it's mostly anti-Semitic because they portray business owners as mostly Jews, but not all of them.
Yeah.
And the worker part of the National Socialist Party, that's becoming very, you know, the idea that these people have now got power, they want to use it for their own benefit. Hitler's under enormous pressure in the summer of 1934. You've got a dying Hindenburg, you got the army who's threatening to go after him, and he's got his own people in the SA who are making sure that he knows that they're not content with being second fiddle. So Hitler did something that kind of like encapsulates who he is. And that's what we call the Night of the Long Knives.
So he's killing by the scores.
Well, up to that point,
no. SA leaders, the stormtroopers who were not going to be integrated into the army. The army wouldn't accept that. But Hitler was not going to have them sort of challenging his authority.
So starting on July 30th, 1934, Hitler himself personally starts arresting his oldest friends and having them shot. One, the most amazing story was Ernst Röhm, who had met Hitler in 1919 after the war, had helped as one of the founders of the Nazi Party. He's the head of the SA. He's one of the people pushing more socialism. And he's shot in a prison cell. The leaders of the SA were picked up all over Germany, mainly in Munich and Bavaria and Berlin, put in front of walls and shot by firing squads. Hmm. As they were being murdered, other groups of killers were going around Germany and picking off people who had been on lists. Journalists, people who were dissidents against Nazism. One of the most famous people who was killed during this was the former Chancellor of Bavaria, who had initially supported Hitler having the putsch in 1923, so 11 years earlier, and then backed out at the last moment. Hermann von Karr was his name. He's murdered. Mm-hmm. The former head of the propaganda wing of the Nazi Party, who had broken with Hitler over his inability to do what he said, shot and killed, and his wife. Former chancellor. It would be like killing a former president of the United States, shot and killed with his wife in his house. Okay. All of this done with papers over basically with warrants that allow you to shoot people as opposed to arrest people. And this is being done by the head of state. One of the most strange things about the Night of the Long Knives is, as it's going along, a couple of days later, Hitler is at the chancellery and hosts a tea party and has people over for tea and cake, and while his thugs are murdering all over Germany. Unbelievable, but true. It really happened. A month later, Hindenburg dies.
Now there's a vacuum, and that position of president is sitting there.
That's right.
So how is he going to maneuver to change the Constitution, or what?
One of the things we haven't mentioned up to this point was that Hitler had the enabling law passed in the aftermath of him becoming chancellor. And what the enabling law stated was that, in March of 1933, is that every law in Germany from that point on was going to be made by Hitler. And that the Reichstag would, in effect, agree to meet but not make their own laws, and their only purpose would be to rubber stamp and vote on laws that Hitler had already decided would happen. In fact, it's a legal dictatorship, but he was still held back by these other forces that we talked about earlier. So legally, at that point, he's got the ability to make any law that he wants.
Reichstag is now just a one-party?
It's a one-party.
Everybody's a Nazi or...
Well, the day that they vote for this, the members of the Reichstag showed up, and those who were not Nazis were informed that however they voted would determine on whether or not they got to go home that day, and would they have a family to go home to. Mm-hmm. The final total was 444 to 94. Can you imagine being one of those 94 people?
Wow.
Men who voted against Hitler.
Pretty bold, yeah.
So he'd already had that in place, but his ability to use it effectively doesn't really kick in until Hindenburg dies in the summer of 1934 in August. Once Hindenburg is dead, the enabling law and the ability to write his own laws allows Hitler to dissolve the office of the presidency. Actually, probably did it before they put Hindenburg in the ground. Dissolve the office of chancellor. And instead create pretty much the office of the Führer, the leader, the primary head of all government in Germany. And so by the end of 1934, the army is then forced to make an oath, not to the German Constitution or German people, but to Adolf Hitler himself. The film of those soldiers taking that oath is chilling. They have to say his name out loud. And again, we've both been to Germany. Laws matter in Germany. Legal tradition, they don't deal with legal changes, you know, casually. Oaths, where you swear. You have German friends, I'm sure, and I do too. One of the great advantages of having friends who are Germans is you'll always have friends who are German. They will be your friends forever. I can pick up the phone and call my German friends today, and their oath of friendship is meaning it's sacred to them in many ways.
There's a formal procedure when you switch from a formal way of speaking to them to an informal.
And so for the thousands of German soldiers who raised their fingers up and took an oath to Adolf Hitler, that was not one that they could walk away from without consequences. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And both personally and certainly professionally. I mean, you couldn't take it back. So when we get to the end of 1934, we have a dictator in place mm-hmm. with a very organized party structure underneath him, and one of the most powerful countries economically, technologically, and Germany's a world leader on so many fields, and it's being run by this gangster. It's incredible, but that's what happened.
So now there's a very kind of a tight structure at the top, but as you say, Germany was a country of law still, and there the establishment of many layers of bureaucracy was to be expected.
It That's
was
right.
a long-standing country with a lot of legal structure behind mm-hmm. it. So did everyone just sort of roll over and say, oh, it's a one-party state now, we have to keep our mouth shut if we're leaders of Bavaria or Hesse, with the states of Germany, we're just going to do what we're told now.
It's really, you can't say with any kind of definitive sense of, a complete answer, that everyone in Germany stepped in line. Most people do. So one of the things that happens in the aftermath of Hitler becoming power and then the death of Hindenburg is the Nazis in the various regions around Germany made a point to spread their wings and get themselves embedded or affiliated with all kinds of other institutions within German society. So garden clubs and what you would see, like today, it's like a softball league, today we mm-hmm. have out the Civic Center. You would see a lot more Nazification of these kind of recreational activities. You would have seen the churches of Germany were in a very interesting position of trying to figure out how to deal with this new change, which caused a lot of power and respect back for Germany, seemingly at the time, with a clear message from the Nazis at the time that they were atheists, and at least in thought and deed, and they felt that the churches held back people more than held back the state more than helped them. So what are you going to do with them? That'll be an interesting question throughout this period of the Nazi relationship with the Catholic Church, particularly in Bavaria, but Lutherans in the north as well. Mm-hmm. Immediately, though, they go after the Jews. Mm-hmm. And the Jewish population of Germany is very quickly made aware that their status as citizens has become, they're no longer citizens. They're second class residents. They are then systematically or chaotically, depending on how you want to look at the way that these laws were passed, stripped of their civil and economic rights. Mm-hmm. There's immediate boycotts of German businesses, Jewish-owned businesses in the cities. Most Jews didn't live anywhere near rural and small-town Germany, so you would have seen a concentration of the Jews in these larger urban areas. They'd been there a long time. Mm-hmm. They'd been integrated into German society to some extent, not a complete extent, but they were a vulnerable population that the Nazis immediately target as one of the causes for all of the problems that had existed before. How many people went along with that is a very good question. Mm-hmm. It's probably one of the central questions of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And as this generation of people who lived through that die off, we may know someday the answer about how many people really did resist the actions of the Nazis. But at the state level, you bring up an interesting point that you have pre-existing laws and institutions that haven't gone away once the Nazis took over. They didn't Nazify everything. So city councils, organizations for like German farmers, how the top business leaders and the stock market, they had they're continuing along with these government agencies. And they're trying to probably imagine how will they adapt and adjust to the Nazi regime. Now, a lot of people at the top felt that this Nazi phenomena was a bunch of hot air, and eventually it would kind of fall on its own contradictions, and Hitler would be a failure. And because of his failure, they would fall out of power, and some other conservative, business-friendly government would replace him. That's not what's going to happen, but they believed that. So the people at the top of German society, the rich people, the industrial leaders, the landowning class, they step back and largely watch. They don't want to have their businesses disrupted, and the landowners don't want to lose their land. And as long as those two things don't happen,
they're willing to go along. For freedom. And there's a building boom that Hitler instigates.
Exactly.
There's a rearmament effort that he begins.
He primes the pump in a major way.
Mm-hmm.
And Germany had infrastructure needs. I mean, they hadn't been destroyed by World War One, but they had a lot of underemployed engineers and civil engineers who could see the Nazis as real. Well, they're going to write the checks. They're going to get the money to make our economy come back. Remember the export economy we talked about that they built before? This continues to some extent, but it's mostly replaced by this internal economy of public works and rearmament. Mm-hmm. Now, the rearmament part's interesting because it's got to be done secretly. At least,
because of the restrictions from the Versailles Treaty.
There were these laws that had been passed by the as part of the Treaty of Versailles, which is the military attachés could go and report back to the French and German British governments about violations. Whether or not the French and the British were going to do anything about it is another question.
Mm-hmm.
We know by what we'll talk about next, the answer was no. But the Treaty of Versailles almost immediately becomes a null and void document, at least in practice for the Nazis, as they start approaching all of the heavy industries in Germany with, here's some contracts, build us some trucks. German army was forbidden to have tanks. Let's start with armored cars. The German Air Force had been completely disbanded. Suddenly, all over Germany, glider clubs appear, with gliders being built by aircraft manufacturers who are immediately taking their earlier peacetime designs, and now they have secret military contracts to rebuild a German Air Force. The buildup of the armed forces is out in the open. You know who helped them, of all people, of all groups? The Russians.
The Russians.
And the Russians watch the buildup of Nazi Germany, Soviet Union, which had been established in the aftermath of World War One. And initially, they don't see them as a threat. Ideologically, you couldn't be more, you know, diametrically opposed. But their belief, the Russian and Stalin's belief, was that the Germans were acting in their own self-interest, and the help that the Red Army could get from sharing information with the German army would be worth whatever supplies and iron ore and whatnot the Russians could give to the Germans. This went on all through the early 1930s,
so
and almost to the end of the war.
Now, we only have a couple minutes left, so I wanted to kind of put a nice bow on this section of this series that clearly must go on.
Right.
So we have a kind of recovering Germany, and politically now consolidated under one leader.
Right.
Could you say a few words just in this last minute about the relationship with the United States? You just mentioned Russia.
A lot of Americans we never signed the Treaty of Versailles. We didn't sign it because of the way it mistreated Germany, but we were not signatories. The understanding of a lot of Americans towards the Germans was that this wasn't all that unusual that a strong leader would come and replace what had been a pretty weak government of a very strong country. There's a lot about Germany that would have been very difficult to control them, and as I said, you know, had the U.S. Army with what was left of the French and the British continue to fight World War One until Germany was crushed completely, might have been a different story, but we didn't do that. And the Germans were not, it didn't make sense to a lot of Americans to hold them down in some kind of physically restraining way with a bunch of sanctions or reparations or treaty obligations. That said, our anti-Semitism in the United States during this period is nothing to be proud of. Mm-hmm. And there were a fair number of Americans who viewed Hitler's hatred of the Jews as maybe not respectable, but not, you know, not alien to people's mm-hmm. attitudes towards Jews here in America. Mm-hmm. Jewish Americans were not considered to be very sympathetic. They were not a favored group of people. They were felt like they must have felt, very many American Jews must have felt like being under siege in their own country. And this, the Depression had such a nationalizing effect on what had been moving towards an international world in the 1920s, where more shared culture, shared ideas, more international connections. The Depression ended a lot of that. And so your attitude, when you're asking about American attitudes towards Germany, it would have been either none or a rough understanding of what was happening, with some prominent people sympathetic.
Yeah. So we'll have to leave it there, but you can see this rather benign-looking Germany, but sort of strange leadership is going to very quickly change in yeah. people's minds, and then there's going to be a real test of American attitudes and global attitudes.
When you think about
growing Germany,
think about where we're leaving today. We're leaving it in 1935, mm-hmm. and Germany in 1935 has been under Nazi control and under Hitler's control for 2 years and then 1 year. 1 year with Hitler pretty much as mm-hmm. undivided Führer. And the attitude of the world towards Germany in 1935 was wait and see. Mm-hmm. Because there was a sense that the Germans might end up making themselves quite strong, but not at the expense of everyone else. Mm-hmm. And that you could see a revived Germany in Europe with a very strong leader, but not with corresponding effects on everybody else, the French, the Czechs, the Poles. And no one who felt that way had ever read Mein Kampf. Because Hitler had said from his prison cell that once he got power, the next step is what we'll talk about in our next program, his foreign policy towards the rest of the world, Europe first and the rest of the world, was laid out for everyone to see. But a lot of people didn't want to read that. They thought, well, once he's got power in Germany,
it'll settle down.
It'll all settle down.
All right, Brian McCall, another outstanding presentation. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me. I so appreciate being here.
It's a real pleasure.
Thank you.